Jules Verne, Round the World in 80 Days, narrated by Sam Kusi. Chapter 1, in which Phileas Fogg and Passepartout accept, relatively, the positions of master and servant. In the year of grace 1872, the house in which Sheridan died in 1816, that is to say, number 7, Savile Road, Burlington Gardens, was occupied by Phileas Fogg, Esquire, one of the most eccentric members of the Reform Club, though it always appeared as if he were very anxious to avoid remark. Phileas had succeeded to the house of one of England's greatest orators, but unlike his predecessor, no one knew anything of Fogg, who was impenetrable, though a brave man and moving in the best society. Some people declared that he resembled Byron, merely in appearance, for he was irreproachable in tone, but still a Byron with whiskers and moustache, an impassible Byron, who might live 1,000 years and not get old. A thorough Briton was Phileas Fogg, though perhaps not a Londoner. He was never seen on the Stock Exchange, nor at the Bank of England, nor at any of the great city houses. No vessel with a cargo consigned to Phileas Fogg ever entered the port of London. He held no government appointment. He had never been entered at any of the inns of court. He had never pleaded at the Chancery Bar, the Queen's Bench, the Exchequer, or the ecclesiastical courts. He was not a merchant, a manufacturer, a farmer, nor a man of business of any kind. He was not in the habit of frequenting the Royal Institution or any other of the learned societies of the metropolis. He was simply a member of the Reform, and that was all. If anyone ever inquired how it was that he had become a member of the club, the questioner was informed that he had been put up by the Barings, with whom he kept his account, which always showed a good balance and from which his cheques were regularly and promptly honoured. Was Phileas Fogg a rich man? Unquestionably. But in what manner he had made his money, even the best informed gossips could not tell, and Mr. Fogg was the very last person from whom one would seek to obtain information on the subject. He was never prodigal in expenditure, but never stingy, and whenever his contribution towards some good or useful object was required, he gave cheerfully, and in many cases, anonymously. In short, he was one of the most uncommunicative of men. He talked little, and his habitual taciturnity added to the mystery surrounding him. Nevertheless, his life was simple and open enough, but he regulated all his actions with a mathematical exactness which, to the imagination of the quidnuncs, was in itself suspicious. Had he ever travelled? It was very probable, for no one was better informed in the science of geography. There was apparently no out-of-the-way place concerning which he had not some exclusive information. Occasionally, in a few sentences, he would clear away the 1,001 rumours which circulated in the club concerning some lost or some nearly forgotten traveller. He would point out the true probabilities, and it really appeared as if he were gifted with second sight, so correctly were his anticipations justified by succeeding events. He was a man who must have been everywhere, in spirit at least. One thing at any rate was certain, that is to say that he had not been absent from London for many a year. Those with whom he was on a more intimate footing used to declare that no one had ever seen him anywhere else but on his way to or from his club. His only amusement was a game of whist, varied by the perusal of the daily papers. At whist, which was a game peculiarly fitted to such a taciturn disposition as his, he was habitually a winner, but his gains always were expended in charitable objects. Besides, it was evident to everyone that Mr. Fogg played for the game, not for the sake of winning money. It was a trial of skill with him, a combat, but a fight unaccompanied by fatigue, and one entailing no great exertion, and thus suiting him down to the ground. No one had ever credited Phileas Fogg with wife or child, which even the most scrupulously honest people may possess, nor even had he any near relatives or intimate friends, who are more rare in this world. He lived alone in his house in Savile Row, and no one called upon him, or at any rate entered there. One servant sufficed for him. He took all his meals at the club, but he never shared a table with any of his acquaintance, nor did he ever invite a stranger to dinner. He only returned home to sleep at midnight precisely, for he never occupied any one of the comfortable bedrooms provided by the reform for its members. 10 hours of the 24 he passed at home, partly sleeping, partly dressing or undressing. If he walked, it was in the entrance hall with its mosaic pavement, or in the circular gallery beneath the dome, which was supported by 20 iconic columns. Here he would pace with measured step. When he dined or breakfasted, all the resources of the club were taxed to supply his table with the daintiest fare. He was waited upon by the gravest black-coated servants, who stepped softly as they ministered to his wants upon a special porcelain service and upon the most expensive damask. His wine was contained in decanters of a now unobtainable mould, while his sherry was iced to the most excellent point of refrigeration of the Wenham Lake. If existence under such circumstances be a proof of eccentricity, it must be confessed that something may be said in favour of it. The house in Savile Row, without being luxurious, was extremely comfortable. Besides, in accordance with the habits of the tenant, the service was reduced to a minimum. But Phileas Fogg exacted the most rigid punctuality on the part of his sole domestic, something supernatural, in fact. On this very day, the 2nd of October, Fogg had given James Forster notice to leave because the fellow had actually brought up his master's shaving water at a temperature of 84 instead of 86 degrees Fahrenheit, and Phileas was now looking out for a successor who was expected between 11 and 11:30. Phileas Fogg was seated in his armchair, his feet close together at the position of attention. His hands were resting on his knees. His body was drawn up. With head erect, he was watching the clock, which, by a complexity of mechanism, told the hours, minutes, seconds, the days of the week, and the month and year. As this clock chimed 11:30, Mr. Fogg, according to custom, would leave the house and walk down to his club. Just then, a knock was heard at the door of the room, and James Forster, the outgoing servant, appeared and announced the new young man for the place. A young fellow of about 30 entered and bowed. "You are a Frenchman and your name is John, eh?" inquired Phileas Fogg. "Jean, sir, if you have no objection," replied the newcomer. "Jean Passepartout, a surname which clings to me because I have a weakness for change. I believe I am honest, sir, but to speak plainly, I have tried a good many things. I have been an itinerant singer, a rider in a circus, where I used to do the trapeze like Leotard and walk the tightrope like Blondin. Then I became a professor of gymnastics, and finally, in order to make myself useful, I became a fireman in Paris, and bear on my back to this day the scars of several bad burns. But it is 5 years since I left France, and wishing to enjoy a taste of domestic life, I became a valet in England. Just now, being out of a situation, and having heard that you, sir, were the most punctual and regular gentleman in the United Kingdom, I have come here in the hope that I shall be able to live a quiet life and forget the name of Jack of all trades, Passepartout. Passepartout suits me, replied Mr. Fogg. I have heard a very good character of you, and you have been well recommended. You are aware of my conditions of service? Yes, sir. Very well. What o'clock do you make it? 11:22, replied the valet, as he consulted an enormous silver watch. You are too slow, said Mr. Fogg. Excuse me, sir. That is impossible. You are 4 minutes too slow. Never mind, it is enough to note the error. Now, from this moment, 11:29 in the forenoon upon this 2nd of October, 1872, you are in my service. As he spoke, Phileas Fogg rose from his chair, took up his hat, put it on his head, as an automaton might have done, and left the room without another word. Passepartout heard the street door shut. It was his new master who had gone out. Shortly afterwards, he heard it shut again. That was his predecessor, James Forster, departing in his turn. Passepartout was then left alone in the house in Savile Row. Chapter 2. Passepartout is convinced that he has attained the object of his ambition. Faith, muttered Passepartout, who, for the moment, felt rather in a flutter. Faith, I have seen creatures at Madame Tussaud's quite as lively as my new master. Madame Tussaud's creatures are all of wax and only want the power of speech. During the short period that Passepartout had been in Mr. Fogg's presence, he had carefully scrutinized his future master. He appeared to be about 40 years of age, with a fine face, a tall and well-made man whose figure was not too stout. He had light hair and whiskers, a clear brow, a somewhat pale face, and splendid teeth. He appeared to possess in a very marked degree that attribute which physiognomists call repose in action, a faculty appertaining to those whose motto is deeds, not words. Calm and phlegmatic, with a clear and steady eye, he was the perfect type of those cool Englishmen whom one meets so frequently in the United Kingdom, and whom Angelica Kaufman has so wonderfully portrayed. Mr. Fogg gave one the idea of being perfectly balanced, like a perfect chronometer, and as well regulated. He was, in fact, the personification of exactness, which was evident in the very expression of his hands and feet. For amongst men, as amongst the lower animals, the members are expressive of certain passions. Phileas Fogg was one of those mathematical people who, never in a hurry and always ready, are economical of their movements. He never made even one step too many. He always took the shortest cut. He never wasted a glance, nor permitted himself a superfluous gesture. No one had ever seen him agitated or moved by any emotion. He was the last man in the world to hurry himself, but he always arrived in time. He lived quite alone and, so to speak, outside the social scale. He knew that in life there is a great deal of friction, and as friction always retards progress, he never rubbed against anybody. As for Jean, who called himself Passepartout, he was a Parisian of the Parisians. He had been for 5 years in England and had taken service in London as a valet de chambre, during which period he had in vain sought for such a master as Mr. Fogg. Passepartout was not one of those fronti or mascariers who, with high shoulders and snubbed noses and plenty of assurance, are nothing more than impudent dunces. He was a good fellow, with a pleasant face, somewhat full lips, always ready to eat or to kiss, with one of those good round heads that one likes to see on the shoulders of one's friends. He had bright blue eyes, was somewhat stout, but very muscular, and possessed great strength. He wore his hair in a somewhat tumbled fashion. If sculptors of antiquity were aware of 18 ways of arranging the hair of Minerva, Passepartout knew but one way of doing his, namely with 3 strokes of a comb. We will not go as far as to predict how the man's nature would accord with Mr. Fox. It was a question whether Passepartout was the exact sort of servant to suit such a master. Experience only would show. After having passed his youth in such a vagabond manner, he looked forward to some repose. Having heard of the proverbial method and coolness of the English gentleman, he had come to seek his fortune in England, but up to the present time, fate had been adverse. He had tried 6 situations, but remained in none. In all of them, he had found either a whimsical, an irregular, or a restless master which did not suit Passepartout. His last master, the young Lord Longsbury, MP, after passing the evening in the Haymarket, was carried home on the policeman's shoulders. Passepartout, wishing above all things to respect his master, remonstrated in a respectful manner, but as his expostulations were so ill received, he took his leave. It was at that time that he heard Phileas Fogg was in search of a servant, and he presented himself for the situation. A gentleman whose life was so regular, who never stayed away from home, who never travelled, who never was absent, even for a day, was the very master for him. So he presented himself and was engaged, as we have seen. Thus it came to pass that at 11:30, Passepartout found himself alone in the house in Savile Row. He immediately commenced to look about him and search the house from cellar to garret. This well-arranged, severe, almost puritanical house pleased him very much. It appeared to him like the pretty shell of a snail, but a snail shell lighted and warmed with gas would serve for both those purposes. He soon discovered the room he was to occupy and was quite satisfied. Electric bells and india rubber speaking tubes put him into communication with the rooms below. Upon the chimney piece stood an electric clock, which kept time exactly with that in Phileas Fogg's bedroom. "This will suit me exactly," said Passepartout to himself. He also remarked in his room a notice fixed above the clock. It was the programme of his daily duties. It included the whole details of the service from 8:00 in the morning, the hour at which Mr. Fogg invariably arose, to 11:30, when he left the house to breakfast at the Reform Club. It comprised everything, the tea and toast at 8:23, the shaving water at 9:37, and his attendance at his master's toilette at 9:40, and so on. Then from 11:30 a.m. until midnight, when the methodical Fogg retired to bed, everything was noted down and arranged for. Passepartout joyfully set himself to study the programme and to master its contents. Mr. Fogg's wardrobe was well stocked and wonderfully arranged. Every pair of trousers, coat or waistcoat bore a number, which was also noted in the register of entries and exits, indicating the date on which, according to the season, the clothes were to be worn. There were even relays of shoes and boots. In fact, in this house in Savile Row, which had been a temple of disorder in the days of the illustrious but dissipated Sheridan, cosiness reigned supreme. There was no library and no books, which would have been useless to Mr. Fogg, since there were 2 reading rooms at the Reform Club. In his bedroom was a small safe, perfectly burglar and fireproof. There were no firearms nor any other weapons in the house. Everything proclaimed the owner to be a man of peaceable habits. After having examined the house thoroughly, Passepartout rubbed his hands joyously, a genial smile overspread his rounded face, and he muttered, This suits me completely. It is the very thing. We understand each other thoroughly, Mr. Fogg and I. He is a thoroughly regular and domestic man, a true machine. Well, I am not sorry to serve a machine. Chapter 3, in which a conversation arises which is likely to cost Phileas Fogg dear. Phileas Fogg left home at 11:30, and having placed his right foot before his left exactly 575 times, and his left foot before his right 576 times, he arrived at the Reform Club in Pall Mall, and immediately went up to the dining room, and took his place at his usual table, where his breakfast awaited him. The meal was composed of one side dish, a delicious little bit of boiled fish, a slice of underdone roast beef with mushrooms, a rhubarb and gooseberry tart, and some Cheshire cheese, the whole washed down with several cups of excellent tea, for which the Reform Club is celebrated. At 12:47, he rose from the table and went into the drawing room. There the servant handed him an uncut copy of The Times, which Phileas Fogg folded and cut with a dexterity which denoted a practiced hand. The perusal of this journal occupied him till 3:45, and then the Standard sufficed till dinner time. This repast was eaten under the same conditions as his breakfast, and at 6:20 he returned to the saloon and read the Morning Chronicle. About 30 minutes later, several of Mr. Fogg's friends entered the room and collected round the fireplace. These gentlemen were his usual partners at whist, and like him, were all inveterate players. They comprised Andrew Stewart, an engineer, the bankers John Sullivan and Samuel Fullentine, Thomas Flanagan, the brewer, and Gautier Ralph, one of the directors of the Bank of England, all rich and men of consequence, even in that club which comprised so many men of mark. "Well, Ralph," asked Thomas Flanagan, "what about this robbery?" "The bank must lose the money," replied Stuart. "On the contrary," replied Ralph, "I am in hopes that we shall be able to put our hand upon the thief. We have detectives in America and Europe, at all the principal ports, and it will be no easy matter for him to escape the clutches of the law." "Then you have the robber's description, of course," said Andrew Stuart. "In the first place, he is not a thief at all," replied Ralph, seriously. "What do you mean? Is not a man a thief who takes away £55,000 in banknotes?" "No," replied Ralph. "He's then a man of business, I suppose," said Sullivan. "The Morning Chronicle assures me that he is a gentleman." This last observation was uttered by Phileas Fogg, whose head rose up from the sea of papers surrounding him, and then Phileas got up and exchanged greetings with his acquaintances. The subject of conversation was a robbery, which was in everyone's mouth, and had been committed 3 days previously, that is to say, on the 29th of September. A pile of banknotes amounting to the enormous sum of £55,000 had been stolen from the counter at the Bank of England. The astonishing part of the matter was that the robbery had been so easily accomplished, and as Ralph, who was one of the deputy governors, explained, that when the £55,000 were stolen, the cashier was occupied in carefully registering the receipt of 3 shillings and 6 pence, and, of course, could not have his eyes in every direction at once. It may not be out of place here to remark, which in some measure may account for the robbery, that the Bank of England trusts greatly in the honesty of the public. There are no guards, or commissioners, or gratings. Gold, silver, and notes are all exposed freely, and, so to speak, at the mercy of the first comer. No one's honesty is suspected. Take the following instance, related by one of the closest observers of English customs. This gentleman was one day in one of the parlours of the bank and had the curiosity to take up and closely examine a nugget of gold weighing 7 or 8 pounds, which was lying on the table. Having examined the ingot, he passed it to his neighbour, he to the next man, and so the gold went from hand to hand, quite down to the dark entry, and was not returned for quite half an hour. And all the time, the bank official had not raised his head. But on the 29th of September, things did not work so nicely. The pile of banknotes was not returned, and when the hands of the magnificent clock in the drawing office pointed to the hour of 5, at which time the bank is closed, the sum of £55,000 was written off to profit and loss. When it was certain that a robbery had been committed, the most skilful detectives were sent down to Liverpool and Glasgow and other principal ports, also to Suez, Brindisi, New York and Co., with promises of a reward of £2,000 and 5% on the amount recovered. In the meantime, inspectors were appointed to observe scrupulously all travellers arriving at and departing from the several seaports. Now, there was some reason to suppose, as the Morning Chronicle put it, that the thief did not belong to a gang, for during the 29th of September, a well-dressed gentlemanly man had been observed in the bank near where the robbery had been perpetrated. An exact description of this person was fortunately obtained and supplied to all the detectives, and so some sanguine persons, of whom Ralph was one, believed the thief could not escape. As may be imagined, nothing else was talked about just then. The probabilities of success and failure were warmly discussed in the newspapers, so it was not surprising that the members of the Reform Club should talk about it, particularly as one of the deputy governors of the bank was present. Ralph did not doubt that the search would be successful because of the amount of the reward, which would probably stimulate the zeal of the detectives. But Andrew Stewart was of a different opinion, and the discussion was continued between these gentlemen during their game of whist. Stewart was Flanagan's partner, and Forlantine was Fogg's. While they played, they did not talk, but between the rubbers, the subject cropped up again. "Well," said Stewart, "I maintain that the chances are in favour of the thief, who must be a sharp one." "But," replied Ralph, "there is no place a fellow can go to." "Oh, come." "Well, where can he go to?" "I can't tell," replied Stewart, "but the world is big enough at any rate." "It used to be," said Phileas Fogg in an undertone. "Cut, if you please," he added, handing the cards to Flanagan. Conversation was then suspended, but after the rubber, Stewart took it up again, saying, "What do you mean by used to be? Has the world grown smaller, then?" "Of course it has," replied Ralph. "I am of Fogg's opinion. The world has grown smaller, inasmuch as one can go round it 10 times quicker than you could 100 years ago. That is the reason why, in the present case, search will be more rapid and render the escape of the thief easier." "You lead, Mr. Stewart," said Fogg. But the incredulous Stewart was not convinced, and he again returned to the subject. "I must say, Mr. Ralph," he continued, "that you have found an easy way that the world has grown smaller, because one now goes round it in 3 months." "In 80 days only," said Phileas Fogg. "That is a fact, gentlemen," added John Sullivan. "You can make the tour of the world in 80 days, now that the section of the Great Indian Peninsula Railway is opened between Rothal and Allahabad. And here is the estimate made by the Morning Chronicle. London to Suez by Montsinus and Brindisi, rail and steamer, 7 days. Suez to Bombay by steamer, 13. Bombay to Calcutta by rail, 3. Calcutta to Hong Kong by steamer, 13. Hong Kong to Yokohama by steamer, 6. Yokohama to San Francisco by steamer, 22. San Francisco to New York by rail, 7. New York to London, steam and rail, 9. Total, 80 days. Yes, 80 days, exclaimed Stuart, who, being absorbed in his calculations, made a misdeal. But that estimate does not take into consideration bad weather, headwinds, shipwreck, railway accidents, etc. They are all included, remarked Fogg, as he continued to play, for this time the conversation did not cease with the deal. Even if the Hindus or Indians take up the rails? Suppose they stop the trains, pillage the baggage wagons, and scalp the travellers? All included, replied Fogg, quietly. Two trumps, he added, as he won the tricks. Stuart, who was pony, collected the cards and said, No doubt you are right in theory, Mr. Fogg, but in practice. In practice too, Mr. Stuart. I should like to see you do it. It only rests with you. Let us go together. Heaven forbid, cried Stuart, but I will bet you a cool 4,000 that such a journey, under such conditions, is impossible. On the contrary, it is quite possible, replied Mr. Fogg. Well then, why don't you do it? Go round the world in 80 days, do you mean? Yes, I will. When? At once. Only I give you warning, I shall do it at your expense. Oh, this is all nonsense, replied Stuart, who began to feel a little vexed at Fogg's persistence. Let us continue the game. You had better deal then. That was a misdeal. Andrew Stuart took up the cards and suddenly put them down again. Look here, Mr. Fogg, he said. If you like, I will bet you 4,000. My dear Stuart, said Foolentine, don't be ridiculous. It is only a joke. When I say I will bet, said Stuart, I mean it. All right, said Mr. Fogg, then, turning towards the others. He said, I have £20,000 deposited at Baring's. I will willingly risk that sum. £20,000? Exclaimed Sullivan. Why, the slightest accident might cause you to lose the whole of it. Anything unforeseen. The unforeseen does not exist, replied Fogg simply. But, Mr. Fogg, this estimate of 80 days is the very least time in which the journey can be accomplished. A minimum well employed is quite sufficient. But to succeed, you must pass from railways to steamers, from steamers to railways, with mathematical accuracy. I will be mathematically accurate. Oh, this is a joke. A true Englishman never jokes when he has a stake depending on the matter. I bet 20,000 against any of you that I will make the tour of the world in 80 days or less. That is to say, in 1920 hours, or 115,200 minutes. Will you take me? We do, replied the others, after consultation together. Very well then, said Fogg. The Dover mail starts at 8:45. I will go by it. This evening, said Stuart. Yes, this evening, replied Fogg. Then, referring to a pocket almanac, he added, This is Wednesday, the 2nd of October. I shall be due in London, in this room, on Saturday, the 21st of December, at 8:45 in the evening, or, in default, the 20,000 at Baring's, to my credit, will be yours, gentlemen. Here is my cheque for that sum. A memorandum of the conditions of the bet was made and signed by all parties concerned. Phileas Fogg was as cool as ever. He had certainly not bet to win the money, and he had only bet £20,000, half of his fortune, because he foresaw that he would probably have to spend the other half to enable him to carry out this difficult, if not actually impossible, feat. His opponents appeared quite agitated, not on account of the value of their stake, but because they had some misgivings and scruples about betting under such conditions. 7 o'clock struck, and it was suggested that the game should stop, while Mr. Fogg made his preparations for the journey. "I am always ready," replied this impassible gentleman as he dealt the cards. "Diamonds are trumps," he added. "You lead, Mr. Stuart." Chapter 4, in which Phileas Fogg astonishes Passepartout. At 7:25, Phileas Fogg, having won 20 guineas at whist, took leave of his friends and left the club. At 8:10, he reached home. Passepartout, who had conscientiously studied his programme, was astonished to see Mr. Fogg appear at such an unusual hour, for, according to all precedent, he was not due in Savile Row till midnight. Phileas Fogg went straight up to his room and called for Passepartout. Passepartout did not reply. It was evident that this could not refer to him. It was not time. "Passepartout!" cried Mr. Fogg again, but without raising his voice. "This is the second time I have called you," said Mr. Fogg. "But it is not midnight," replied Passepartout, producing his watch. "I know that," replied Fogg. "And I do not blame you. We start for Dover and Calais in 10 minutes. A sort of grimace contracted the Frenchman's round face. He evidently did not understand. "Are you going out, sir?" he asked. "Yes," replied his master. "We are going round the world." Passepartout, at this announcement, opened his eyes to their greatest extent, held up his arms, and looked the picture of stupefied astonishment. "Around the world," he muttered. "In 80 days, replied Mr. Fogg. "So we have not a moment to lose." "But the luggage," said Passepartout, who was wagging his head unconsciously from side to side. "We want no luggage. A carpet bag will do. Pack up 2 nightshirts and 3 pairs of socks, and the same for yourself. We will buy what we want as we go along. Bring my mackintosh and travelling cloak down with you, and a couple of pairs of strong boots, although we shall have little or no walking. Look alive!" Passepartout wished to speak, but could not. He left his master's bedroom and went upstairs to his own, fell into a chair, and exclaimed, "Well, this is coming it pretty strong, and for me too, who wanted to be quiet." Mechanically, he set about making preparations for departure. Around the world in 80 days. Had he engaged himself with a maniac? No, it was only a joke. But they were going to Dover and to Calais. So far, so good. After all, he did not object to that very much, for it was 5 years since he had seen his native land. Perhaps they would even go on to Paris, and he would be delighted to see the capital again. No doubt a gentleman so economical of his steps would stop there. But on the other hand, this hitherto very domestic gentleman was leaving home. That was a fact. At 8:00, Passepartout had packed the small bag which now contained his master's luggage and his own, and, in a very troubled frame of mind, he quitted his room, closed the door carefully, and went downstairs to Mr. Fogg. That gentleman was quite ready. Under his arm, he carried a copy of Bradshaw's Continental Guide. He took the small bag from Passepartout, opened it, and placed therein a bulky roll of banknotes, which will pass in any country. "You are sure you have not forgotten anything?" he asked. "Quite sure, sir. You have my mackintosh and travelling cloak. Here they are, sir." "All right, take the bag." And Mr. Fogg handed it back to the man. "You had better take care of it," he added. "There are £20,000 in it." Passepartout nearly let the bag fall, as if it were weighted with the £20,000 in gold. Master and man went downstairs together. The door was shut and double locked. Phileas called a cab from the bottom of Savile Row and drove to Charing Cross Station. It was 8:20 when they reached the railway. Passepartout jumped out. His master followed and paid the cabman. At this moment, a poor beggar woman, carrying a baby, looking very miserable with her naked feet and tattered appearance, approached Mr. Fogg and asked for alms. Mr. Fogg drew from his waistcoat pocket the 20 guineas he had won at whist, and handing them to the beggar woman, said, "Take these, my good woman. I am glad I have met you." He then entered the station. This action of his master brought the tears into Passepartout's susceptible eyes. Mr. Fogg had risen in his estimation. That eccentric individual now told him to take 2 first-class tickets for Paris, and as he turned round, he perceived his 5 friends from the Reform Club. "Well, gentlemen, you see, I am about to start, and the visas on my passport on my return will convince you that I have performed the journey." "Oh, Mr. Fogg," replied Gautier Ralph, politely, "that is quite unnecessary. We believe you to be a man of your word."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.